Anti-Radicalisation in Commonwealth. Member of panel, welcome. I would like to start from Margaret to introduce, for a minute, introduce yourself, each one, which we, I know, of course, I don't, perhaps I do not do enough justice to introduce you, please.
Most of you know me, I'm Margaret Ali, I'm director of UPF in UK. I've worked a lot in bringing people together, so radicalization is a sticky topic, and I think there are things we can do to improve things.
My name is retired Commander Suhaib Farooq. I'm from Pakistan. By profession, flyer turned into businessman and a philanthropist. I'm working in the education sector, plus I'm the deputy governor of Rotary International Pakistan for 2015-16.
My name is Raja Sikandar Khan. I'm a chairman of Global Pakistan Kashmir Supreme Council. We do work for the community, local community, and the overseas community globally from Pakistan and Kashmir. And at present, I am working on Kashmir issue as well as doing work for the community.
I'm very smart.
Hello, good afternoon, everyone. My name is Adese Ekweme. I'm the CEO of Etioni Development Group. We're a community development organization based in southwest Nigeria. Our aim is to transform a rural town into a model smart town. I spoke yesterday, if anyone was around. I'm also a postgraduate research student at St. Anne's College, University of Oxford, and I work with the BT Institute of Major Programs. Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Keith Best. I'm chief executive of a national charity called Survivors UK, which cares clinically and also raises awareness about for men who've been sexually abused. Before that, I ran a charity called Freedom from Torture, which cared for torture survivors from all over the world. Before that, I ran one called the Immigration Advisory Service, which provided legal advice and representation to immigrants and asylum seekers. And before that, I ran another charity called Prisoners Abroad, which cared for prisoners who are incarcerated overseas. I'm a practicing barrister by profession. I was an MP for 8 years, and I'm also the chairman of the executive committee of an international NGO called the World Federalist Movement, which has been very prominent in promoting the International Criminal Court, extending its jurisdiction, and also the number of states that are signatories and who've ratified that. Also, the concept of responsibility to protect. And in fact, we host the Coalition for the International Criminal Court, which is an international grouping of 2,500 NGOs worldwide. So I've got a strong focus on the international arena.
Yes, thank you. Just hold it. What I have, excellent. I would like to initiate the panel by saying one or two points and issues. Ladies and gentlemen, radicalization is wrong. And I would like to get a member of audience, all the brothers and sisters, to join in. If they want to join in. There is no problem. It's a debate which has to be solved. Radicalization is wrong. The subject of radicalization and de-radicalization affect many people in the world. Many lost their lives. Many have been imprisoned. Many have been kidnapped. Many executed. Not only people suffering, but the nation, the country suffering. Few points which we discuss. How we can stop a person to radicalize many, we can see. How does one radicalize? Why a young person get trapped and become radicalized, become extremist, terrorist, ISIS, etc.? Is it because not having a job? A good future? Affected by media? Affected by what's seen in the internet? Foreign policies? Lost his hope and wants to do something? Religious duties? His country been occupied. What he or she or group want to achieve. Points. What we as individual can do in order to stop young people to be radicalized. What the community, society, and government can do to stop it. And what is the best method to stop radicalization? What is happening in Pakistan, Afghanistan, Nigeria, Sri Lanka, Bangladesh, South Africa, and UK, and others? Let's open the discussion.
Right, good evening, everybody. First of all, I just want to say the radicalization or the extremism, terrorism, it is born through, in my own opinion, through poverty, through your upbringing, through your background, through your education. If a person is deprived of something in his upbringing or in his education, then obviously he falls into wrong society and wrong hands. And I think our society, ourselves, we have a main role to play to overcome this radicalization. It's every one of us duty to look into this deeply and do whatever in your capacity to overcome this issue. A few weeks ago, I was at a TV station doing a debate, live it was, and my anchor asked me, it was on a Kashmir issue, the present human rights violations committed in Kashmir. And I was asked by the anchor, are you in favor? Just yes or no. He didn't give me option to, he said, are you in favor of these people taking up arms and fighting with the armed forces? Well, I said, it's a difficult question to answer in yes or no. I can't give you yes or no just like that. I have to obviously tell you in details. I said, what would you do if your daughter, if your sister was raped in front of you? If your son, your father, your brother was tortured in front of you and killed in front of you, what have you got to live for? What would you do? I said, I don't know about you, but I would do whatever in my capacity to do harm that person and to safeguard my family and my home. So my initial answer to you would be, no, I am against any civilian person to pick up an arm and kill somebody. I'm against of killing or torture of any innocent person. But when my house, my family is attacked and I cannot do anything, then obviously I have to do something.
Thank you, we'll come back to you. Margaret.
I was recently at a conference of UPF with three regions, and then there was a panel on radicalization. And a friend of mine, ours actually, our friend, Edwin Shukar, was speaking. And I was completely mesmerized the way he approached the topic. And I would like to share that with you. He said, this is a very sad thing, what's happening. You know, people are being killed, la la la. We all know it. We don't have to talk about it. We know it. It's bad. But he said, how many people in this room actually stop to think, take time to think. Why does a young man, we're talking about Britain now because he's from England and I'm from England, how does a young man who's been university graduate, very well educated, coming from a middle class family, leaves the country without informing the parents, goes to fight in Syria? Did anybody of you stop to think? So nobody said anything. And then he said, well, there's this man, there's another man who is more like what Mr. Raja is talking about, that, you know, she's lost everything, all values, and doesn't know what to do, losing the family. Okay, that's a desperate person. But you know, he said, in every case, it is because we failed them. And he had tears in his eyes. He said, in every case, it's because, he was talking, we as more collective people of value, of goodness, whatever, people who think they know what they're doing, you know? Because he's a very much interfaith man. He's an Orthodox Jew, but a fantastic heart for interfaith. So he said, you know what? Everybody needs, in a little way, the previous speaker, what's her other name? Bennett, was saying something about the inner, you know, desire to do things, inner desire. Everybody needs something to feel a vacuum. You could call it emotional intelligence, you could call it a spirit, you could call it a place where you actually go in there when you're in need, you know? Our conscious, we need it. We need some kind of thing to guide us. He said, we have not thought about these people's need. We have failed them desperately. Yes. And everybody agreed, you know? It is because our education system is crazy. Our religious leaders, sorry, any leaders here, are a bit crazy, you know? And our whatever, wherever we looking for values, we're not happy. In fact, if you're religious, there's something wrong with you in this secular society. Do you understand? So therefore, it's nothing to do with religion. It's more to do with that inner depth that you need to fit in. It needs understanding of humans. In UPF, we believe that we are one family under God. And if we are so, then every child that you see suffering can be your child. That's how you have to view it. You know, if you can't view it that way, then we cannot really live in service of others. You know? So therefore, as we are sitting here, even each person is related to each other. So we have to understand how, as a family, we can help the family that needs to help more.
Excellent. Thank you, Margaret. And third case, please.
Thank you very much. We claim to be a civilized society here, and indeed many other countries and people around the world who are suffering oppression and hardship look to this country as being a haven of civilization. So it is horrendous when you get that in this evening's newspaper. Absolutely horrendous. Why is this happening? Why in a so-called civilized country have we got hate crime soaring in the way that it is? And I think you cannot dissociate it from the result of the referendum here in what, for me, was the worst political decision in my lifetime. And I think we are reaping the whirlwind of that. But I think the reason so many people voted to leave the EU was not about the EU. I don't think many people, and myself included, understand the full complexities of membership of the European Union. They voted because it was a vote against the political establishment, what I call English Trumpism. It is people who have not been involved in politics at all very often before in their lives, wanting to use an opportunity to actually tell the political class that you have left us behind. Globalization has left us behind. We no longer feel we are belonging. We no longer feel you as politicians are speaking our language or talking to us in meaningful ways. Now, we're here to discuss radicalization, but it seems to me you cannot dissociate radicalization from two other elements that are stalking the world and individual societies at the moment. One is isolationism and the other is intolerance. Yes. Isolationism, I think, comes in two forms. It comes in national isolationism. We're seeing a diminution in global trade at the moment. We're seeing more protectionism coming around about goods. We're seeing nations turning in on themselves. In Europe, we see Hungary building walls against migrants, something that would have been inconceivable 30 years ago. We're seeing nations actually turning in on themselves, and that fosters and promotes the kind of isolationism which is then translated into the individual, because individuals are now much more isolated. Whether you subscribe to the awful advert of "because I'm worth it," you know, I've been trying to teach our two daughters for many years that proper use of English is you say "Johnny and I," not "me and Johnny," and yet they persist. And all young people now put themselves first in the language. Mm-hmm. I fear that many of us are putting ourselves first rather than other people in the way in which we conduct our early lives. So that's isolationism, both at the state level and at the individual level, but also the intolerance. I mentioned what's happening in, or what has happened in Hungary, and I think there is an increasing amount of intolerance in the world now. I think there's also an increasing amount of indifference, and Syria is the best example of that. Yes, it's a ticklish problem, and it doesn't admit of easy answers, but the fact that the Western world has so easily allowed it to carry on without determined action is a sense of indifference to the suffering of the people there. And it's a double whammy, because when those people then flee from that persecution, of course, they then try to come to Europe and they find a brick wall built against them. So my conclusion is this, that it's not an easy answer. It's even more difficult to implement. But frankly, the answer to radicalization is to make people feel they are included. They are included in society, that society cares for them. Because although you can't generalize on this, many people who go off and join Daesh or who actually become radicalized are people who feel that they're outside society. There's something better for them. They want to fight for something better. They don't exist the status quo because they feel it's left them behind. So again, easy to say, much more difficult to implement. But until we as a society and the global community says we must talk of inclusion rather than exclusion, in the way Margaret was saying just a moment ago, where we treat the whole of humanity as one family and every person matters, then we're not going to, frankly, offer a significant answer to this problem.
Come on this way.
Thank you. As Sheikh Ramzy has asked about what is the definition of the radical people, there's a proverb that let's work as a team and you all do whatever I say. So basically this is a mindset that whatever I'm saying is the right thing, or whatever I'm doing is the right thing. This is the radical mindset. So we need to understand that radical mindset is not necessarily we are finding in the mountains of Afghanistan. We need to differentiate that radical mindset can be anywhere, which can rather improving the situation can always worsen it. So So we need to understand that radical mindset is bad for the humanity. For your next question, how to deal with it, I think rightly it has been said with the two August speakers here that we need to think bigger, and on a bigger canvas we need to make a picture. We all are the sons and daughters of Adams, and now we were divided and we are living in different parts just for the identification, not for the divisions and divisions and divisions and divisions and then hatreds. Then Europe and Brexit we are talking about, and these all are divisions. Instead we need to get together, and then we need to find out that what is the problem with that kind of thinking. As rightly my lovely friend Barrister Hayat has said, that instead of sending the aircrafts with full of missiles, we need to send the food they require, maybe, or the wisdom messages, or the love and affection, maybe, at time. Only love and affection, if somebody is having some problems, economic problems, maybe we cannot help that much, but just a pet that, okay, no problem, things will get better, may work. We need to, you know, as a Rotarian, sometimes whenever I come across people of that kind of community, I find that sometimes only few words will work. So we need to choose our words also for those people, so that we should get together now instead of division, further divisions. How can we just overcome is the only one way. Number one, awareness and selection of our own words, also very important. And then education, through education, we need to spread the word. We need to spread the love and affections. And we need to feel if somebody is hungry, or somebody is in problems, or somebody is having, somebody's sick in Africa, we must feel the pain here. Then we are one family, one human beings. We are sons and daughters of the Adams then. And if we are thinking that that is not my headache, then someday that headache will come to me. It will reach my home. So at that time, then again just going and killing that person will not solve the problem, because then another problem will start up. His brother will say, my brother has been killed, or my son has been killed, or my father has been killed. I am going to take my revenge. So the infinity kind of a war will continue.
Thank you, Commander.
Thank you.
Thank you. I just have very few words to say on radicalization. I'm not going to pretend to be an expert here, but I am a Nigerian citizen, so I can't speak firsthand to the developments in my country in the past 14, 15 years. For me, radicalization, I believe, is based merely on misinformation. It's giving people maybe snippets of information and tweaking it to shaping some perceptions that are not always accurate. And it's finding the right sorts of victims to buy into this. I can say in Nigeria, we have quite a lot of tribes. I'm Igbo, I'm from the southeast. I went to what we call a federal government school, which is owned by the federal government, not the state. So they bring a lot of us from all over the country into one school. And the rule there was, you were not allowed to speak in your native language. We all had to communicate in English. We were also Muslims and Christians. I grew up, I never ever saw any difference between myself and I'm a Christian. I never saw any difference between myself and a Muslim or myself and anybody else from another tribe in my country. But then as things started progressing, you know, and I guess after the 9/11, because Boko Haram came about in 2002 in Nigeria, a year after. And in the sense of looking for a sense of identity, a few extreme people in the northern part, and when I say a few, this is not the general view of your typical Muslim in Nigeria, where all we live in unity, mainly, apart from these extremists. And they found a way to say that they are being marginalized in the north, and it's the people in the south that have money. And they got a lot of, you know, spread a lot of information that was false and targeted people that didn't have that much access to education and felt marginalized. So those people were very easy to coerce to whatever agenda that they had. But in summary, what I'm really trying to get at is one thing I've noticed now with young people nowadays, there's no sense of community that I feel that I had as a teenager. As a teenager, I could get with my friends, we could go out, we had social interactions, we were together. Now, you see most of these kids are in their rooms, parents don't know what they're doing, you don't have access to the internet. If I wanted to watch TV in my house, my mother was sitting right there. I can't watch anything that she doesn't know. We don't even know what these young people are being exposed to now. And we don't know who we're inviting into our homes. We're not there when they're opening the internet. We don't know who's there with them. So I think it goes back to the fundamentals of community and also just trying to know what our kids are doing as much as we can in this present day society. Thank you.
Thank you. Of course, if ladies and gentlemen want to question, bring your hand up and a question. Just, I was going to ask first this one and after that your question. They say, you said misinformation. How much what I'm trying to say, we got people blaming the religion for the radicalization. How much of the religious education is misinformation? I put it for the because we got in the commando which he has in the Pakistan, we have a lot of difficulties in Pakistan.
Religious education basically as earlier also I told in my presentation that every religion is a religion of peace, is having some scruples, principles, and that is in favor of humanity, it is not against it. But whenever we are saying radicalization is taking refuge in different parts, sometimes it is part of the drug players, at times it has taken place refuge in some religious institutions also. We must understand this, that does not mean that all the religion institutions are part of the radicalization. We need to differentiate.
Thank you. Please, and after that, just 2 minutes, because
I think we should not be too harsh on religion. We shouldn't blame religion. Religion is used as an excuse. It's not a real motivation. People pervert the name of every religion, and every religion is subject to that kind of perversion. Christianity, Islam, you name it. We see in India now, I'm sorry, I hope I don't offend anybody, but the cult going on there, which is again exclusionary about the promotion of Hinduism, and there is a role for religion, but it has to be one of individual conscience. Once it is used as a tool by anybody, whether it be by a government or a sect that seeks to impose its will, it is being perverted and used very often wholly against the fundamental tenets of that religion, because as we've heard, all religions are peaceful. They all actually promote peace. They also actually all promote something you were saying about community, about, you know, in Christianity, the parable of the Good Samaritan, you know, who is my brother? My brother, my sister is my neighbor. How often do we see that practiced? I mean, the sad thing is, I do think I have some sympathy with Margaret's view that some religious leaders are not actually doing quite as much as they should, which is to promote the positive aspects of religion, that it is religion is inclusive, even if one particular religion is seen slightly differently from another, but particularly the Abrahamic faiths have so much in common, more in common than that which divides them. And we need to hear more about that being put across, about the positive aspects of Islam, for example, to counter the way it is totally perverted. We're seeing more of that now, but not nearly enough, where imams and religious leaders speak out and say, this is not Islam. People may claim it is. They may say Allah Akbar every time they commit an outrage, but it's got nothing to do with Allah.
Thank you. Questions, please. Question has to be very short. Only question, no comment, because we haven't got time. What we would like... In the panel, please take a seat and we get somebody else.
They don't have another.
Okay. Just, yeah. Somebody helps, please, because he's a member of the panel. That gentleman was on the back. Please, okay, on the back, that was first one. Very short, and I say who is there is no time.
Okay. Hello, my name is Munir. I was invited by my good friend Tony to come, and I only became politically active when Jeremy Corbyn was running for the leadership. I would like to see or hear from the panel radicalization in a more inclusive context, because one of the issues in terms of radicalization is a vacuum of power, or more importantly, a vacuum of justice. So if, for instance, Assad drops a barrel bomb on his people in Aleppo, that's radicalization. If a gangster or gang member shoots someone in Southall, that's a form of radicalization. We only seem to talk about radicalization in the context of a counterpower, you know, in a sense when it affects us. So if it's Islamic extremists, it's a counterpower to Western imperialism, so we talk about radicalization. Or we don't like the way Iran is doing things, so we don't want them round the table in Syria.
Make it short, please, because
yeah, sorry,
no
I just,
time.
Yeah,
sorry.
I understand. I just want to, yes, I just want to see, so that's a form of radicalization. So I want to see the panel talk about radicalization in a more inclusive manner, and also to just talk a little bit more about soft power, not in terms of relief, but in terms of empowerment. And you mentioned you were doing something in Nigeria.
Thank you, very kind. Our commander, because it's very important, and the second.
Take a few more.
We forgot. Just get the one by one. We do one by one, please. Just take it one by one, please. Otherwise, we don't get. Please, take one by one. Just
it takes much longer,
please.
In my
opinion. Very kind. And we take it again.
Yes, you are right. Already I told you that we need to have a bigger canvas. And you are right that if we try to just analyze the drug lords have caused more damage to the humanity and they are more powerful, but only problem is that they are killing the humanity and we are not understanding. Mm-hmm. And these radical people, they kill three people or four people in a bomb blast, and our media is already a machine to make a perception, and in perception, in cameras are there on those three bodies, and the same day, if you calculate the whole world figures due to heroin or due to your drugs, maybe more than 5,000 people are dying.
and we are not understanding. So we need to have, definitely you are right, radicalization is definitely a much larger figures, and we need to address each one of them, because each one of them is related. Already I told you that they are being paid by those people, and sometimes they are taking the refuge there. So,
a second, please.
Right, I don't know how to define. This topic we're talking about. I think we could be here all day discussing this matter in details if we go into depth of it. But obviously, you're very right. Radicalization is even in politics in every country to different countries. There's in poverty, in like Commander Saab said, in drugs. I mean, there's so much in it we could go into. It'll take ever to define. The meaning
it's
of
a mindset.
That's right, it's a mindset altogether. Thank
can,
you.
I, can I just say some, yeah. one little thing? I don't think all of us should say. The reason is
that's what
if we get three people to say something and anyone who
that
wants
we can do, allow me to do it. I'm the moderator. Yeah. I shall do it.
No, please. Because I have time.
That's all right. I shall say. No. Please.
Okay. My point is to Leon. Is it Leon? Your name? Munir. Munir Marhaba. Okay. My point to Munir is, you know, we. As parents, as community leaders, as, well, people of understanding, peacekeepers, whatever you want to call it, we want to do something about something we can do something about. We can do something about our children. We can do something about our young people. But we cannot do much with the, you know, the baron, the drug barons, or you know, it's we don't have access to them. Whereas our children in this country, even if they're the children of other people, I have a relationship and responsibility. I feel that's why we're talking about that area of radicalization rather than the whole world.
Thank you. In my opinion. What's your case, please?
Thank you. I'll be very brief because many people want to get in.
That's right.
I don't have a problem with radical thoughts and radical ideas. I mean, we live in a democracy and people should have the right to be able to express those thoughts and views. I may fundamentally disagree with them, but that's my duty and my obligation to express that vocally. The problem with radicalization is when that is taken into extreme forms and violence, yes. Then it becomes unacceptable. But we have to be very, very careful, I think, in our attempt to try to exclude radical motivation for people to exercise violence, that we don't end up doing the terrorist work for them. By so curtailing freedom of speech, I am profoundly concerned about some of these ideas about banning certain speakers, for example, from universities or things like this. Right. What's the answer to that? It is education, something you mentioned. It is education. Allow people, give people the tools with which to expose the fallacies in the radical ideas and let them come to their own conclusions. Once you start excluding the ideas, you then foment further dissension. In fact, people then turn to the barricades because they feel they have no opportunity to express things otherwise in a free democracy.
Thank you. I take it one by one, and it's because I want to see who can answer the question. It's a very important, short, and who can answer the question the best way to contribute. It's not just to talk for the panel. It's who can do the contribution. Thank you very much. So, short and
yes, I want to find. I want the panel to look into the relationship of mental health, because the mind is abnormal to be so radicalized, to be violent. So how can we prevent? How can we do assessment, or how can we offer mental health services before people become dangerously radicalized? Number one, and also how can we teach religious tolerance from childhood, both from home and also from schools in all societies? And the leaders of these countries, there's violence and radicalization, they should take responsibilities, because it's the leaders of the radicalized group that manipulate vulnerable minds that join
think,
them.
Do you think you said these radicals are mental?
Yes, okay. It's abnormality. Thank you very much. It's no normal people will be killing other people.
Yeah, Keith.
Psychopath.
Thank you very much. No. Keith and Margaret and.
Very briefly, we all have mental health.
I agree.
It's not sometimes seen as being sane and sober, at other times it's not. But, you know, what is it? One in four people will actually have some deterioration in their mental health at some stage in their lives. Some of those people have that visited on them more regularly. I'm dealing with a field now of male survivors from sexual abuse where that is a very common occurrence and leads to self-harm and in some cases harm to others as well. First of all, we have to acknowledge that we've all got mental health and each person is exercising that in a different way. But I think that I'm glad to see that the government now is actually putting more resources into mental health because it is absolutely important to do that. Because as I think you rightly intimate, if you allow things to play with your mind, that's when you start doing irrational things.
Thank you. Margaret?
I don't need to talk.
You have got, okay.
But you know, other people talk first.
Yours. You want? Very, very short, because we've got plenty of people. No, wait, please. One time.
First of all, I think it's our moral duty as parents in do your level best in upbringing of your children. Teach them the best thing possible, and obviously when they grow up, they know they'll be able to sense which is right and which is wrong. I think that is my...
Excellent, thank you. Yes. Introduce yourself as well, it's good. Is it working?
Yes.
Good.
We have saying in our country, is father and mother is very important, but better than father and mother is knowledge. Knowledge is better than. I think the politician in the world, they using everything to people not getting the right knowledge, and they using the religious. Interface is very important, or education. Thank you very much.
Please, just a question. We don't want to comment. Please, next one. This gentleman was, I think this gentleman.
I'd like to give all honor and praises to the Yahwa, the creative source behind Abraham, Yitzchak, Yaakov, Ishmael, and all other prophets. How do you place the wanton grab for materials? You know, you look at a country like Afghanistan, where they're going after the copper, the gold, the iron ore. You look at Africa and you see AFRICOM all around, where it's something like 100 or so military establishments going after the coltan in the Congo, the oil.
Thank you.
In those places, or you're looking at Syria, and you're seeing that being the crossroads and the pipelines from Kyrgyzstan and from Russia coming down, and all that juxtaposition, how much is that causing this radicalization and this genocide?
We got the question.
And then not look at the rest of the multinationals that's pushing sugar for attention deficit disorders, these things. How is all that impacting on the average
Thank you very much.
The average
there
person?
Is no time. You've got about 20 people to talk. Please. Commander and there is not enough time. Sorry about that. There is not enough time. Otherwise...
Okay, thank you. Sorry, just to be clear. So you're asking about how all these differences of having this wealth around and being poor.
The multinational that are going outside yes.
I can't say exactly. I mean, it's one of those things, as I said when I was speaking, that radicalization is based mainly on highlighting differences that people have and misinformation. So once someone sees, okay, well, they have all this wealth in this area, but they're not actually reaping the benefits, it does tend to push them towards extremism. I can't necessarily speak and say what is right or what is wrong, but I can say, for example, in Nigeria, in the Niger Delta, that was part of how they got people really riled up to say, okay, well, there's all this wealth of oil around and these multinational companies are coming in. So I guess, yes, they do play quite a big part in moving people towards extremism, but I don't know the solution. I think we need to bring in the Shells and the BPs to fend for themselves.
Hi there. My question.
The lady at the back. The lady at the back.
My question is very similar.
The lady at the back.
They gave me the mic.
No, can we? Please. That lady, and after that, just click. Margaret, please let me sort it out. Otherwise, we're getting just let me sort it out, please.
No, matter.
Thank you.
Okay. No, because okay, now I'm Celine from Turkey. I'm doing my PhD at Media and Culture on the conflict resolution, and also I'm working as a freelance journalist. And the killers from Orlando, from Paris, from Brussels, they are big threats for us, and yes, we know that they are radicals, and they are doing this on behalf of Islam and on behalf of God, on behalf of Allah, and so now it's a big threat for the West and for the Islam. It is the radicalization of the Islam or Islamization of the radicalism. So could you please explain this?
Can you bring one of the, we have two microphones. Can you bring one, please, here? And one, we got that brother. Can you say your question as well, please? We get in together. There is no time. We got a few minutes more.
Yeah, I just want to begin with a quote by a lady by the name of Professor Wangui Maathai. Says she died a couple of years ago. And she said that distribution of resources will always be a problem to the world. Greed is the word I'm looking for here, and I haven't seen it being mentioned by the panel there, because greed has brought about problems in Somalia, problems in just the border between Somalia and Kenya, Sudan, northern Nigeria, and it's greed which is the key thing, and I would want that to be mentioned, because at one point Margaret Thatcher, the former British Prime Minister, said she didn't want the debt of $50 billion of Nigeria to be paid by, to be written off by the World Bank, because she knows of five people who can settle Nigeria's debt. That means there's a lot of greed in the world. So distribution of resources is the key that should be mentioned.
For the first question, I'll put it in a panel. First question.
Okay. First of all, greed has been with us ever since Adam took the apple from the tree, and it's going to stay with us, I'm afraid. That is a feature. All you can do about greed is to introduce a social conscience, and this ties in with the question about multinationals. Multinationals have shareholders. You can get to those shareholders. You can actually exercise them. They're already taking a stance in some cases with BP, for example, about directors' salaries. It's now for all of us, I think, to actually get them exercised about some of the environmental impact and things of that nature. So it's not a lost battle. Yes, you need scrutiny, you need international scrutiny, but also you need the conscience being injected into the companies and indeed governments where they do the same thing. I just want to come very briefly back to this question about knowledge. We are the information society. We have more access to knowledge and information now than any previous generation. It is how that is used and what is available that really matters. And the trouble is, you can give a child of 10 an iPhone and they take it into their bedroom, and you might as well actually send a television camera crew in there, both in terms of downloading and uploading. What the problem is that they are going to be exposed to all kinds of images and ideas, but won't have the maturity to be able to deal with it. And that's why we come back to this question again of education. You can't close down the society. We're not living in a world anymore where the Germans in the last World War banned the use of the BBC, and that being the only access to disinterested news. We are now in an information technology where even people in North Korea are actually getting access to outside information through the internet, however much at a hazard to their own lives. So that the genie is out of the bottle. What we've got to do is obviously scrutinise the content, but more importantly, give people the judgment, the ability, the education to be able to sort out the wheat from the chaff.
Thank you very much. Mr. Skander, and of course...
Right. My answer to the lady at the back from Turkey, who is doing a PhD, first of all, let me say to you, there's goodies and baddies everywhere in the world, in every race. And we, I mean, one single person from one race or one religion becomes a lunatic and goes around blowing people up or blowing buildings up. I'm not going to blame his religious or his community or his background. I think the person who did that, he didn't do it for the on the name of Allah or on name of Islam. That's totally not unacceptable. I'm sorry. These people are sick. They are doing for obviously other reasons, for greed or maybe other reasons, but not for definitely for sake of this. Thank you.
Yes, you are right. Basically, I think, again, the same thing that we need to readdress the issues in a way that we find out actual where is the problem. Instead of this, your words, is it Islam is being radicalized or other way around, this is also a proper mindset. And we need to see beyond the mindset, beyond the perceptions. We need to understand the problems, and then we can solve, as R. Covey, in his bestseller book, Eighth Habit, he says that a person is three parts, having heart, mind, and body. And we need to understand wherever is the radical mind, may it be in any part of the country, any part of the world, because we are in a global village, anywhere present radical mind is our problem we need to understand and address.
Thank you, Komal. Margaret, would you like to say something? It's a minute, and after that, 1 minute. Keith, 1 minute is a conclusion. I'm sorry, there is no time. I tried my best to get all everybody's in, but couldn't do it. 1 minute conclusion.
It's been a very interesting debate. I think the answers we're searching for can be summed up in respect, inclusion, and education. We need to teach people to respect other people's views, their cultures, their religions, even if we fundamentally disagree with them. You disagree with people by arguing. You don't disagree with them at the point of a barrel of a gun. And the inclusion, I think, is terribly important, both at the local level, the family level, the community level, and the global level, to actually make people feel that they are part of an overall significant scheme, and that they matter, and they are each one is important. And education, I merely reiterate what I said earlier, it is the gift of education is the greatest one of all. When people are educated, they know how to make choices, and that's the salvation to stopping radicalization, quite frankly.
Thank you.
Yes, so just to conclude as well, we've addressed it from the point of view, mainly let's say 100% from the point of view of the people that have been radicalized and how we can educate them. But I think we also need to look into ourselves as well and see how we can be a bit more inclusive from our, not just for them to be educated, but for us to also make the effort. And I'll just end with a very common African proverb. It says, "If you want to go far, go. If you want to go fast, go alone. But if you want to go far, go together." Thank you very much.
Right. The conclusion thing is, we can. I mean, obviously, we didn't have enough time to discuss everything in details, but
sorry.
Lack of time. But my answer would be
love and affection would be a big tool in this to reduce the radicalization.
To me, basically, your positive attitudes, your good grooming, and education with a comprehensive character building is the final destination which can be achieved. Otherwise, right now, we are in a mess. And we can just do some kind of maintenance work somewhere, but the whole thing can be achieved only in the future. Let's hope and pray that we move to that side.
Okay, finally. I will just say I changed my mind. I think we have to give all people opportunity, particularly our young people, opportunity to know their neighbor. It's very, very important that we show them who their neighbor is, that they have opportunity to work together, to play together, to understand one another. This is paramount. Because if you know your neighbor, you have already eliminated the doubt. Of course, it's part of education just to do that, but it's also an action. As parents, as community leaders, we really have to work on that. We really have to educate, get people together to do things together. And we have very many different ways of doing that.
Thank you again. We are very sorry. We couldn't. Everybody has a question, but of course, that was excellent. Again, you can find one our panelists later and ask a question. Excellent panelists. Put your hand together again for our panelists. Thank you very much. God bless. Up on here, anything goes. Put it together.